There are two types of sleep apnea. There's obstructive and central sleep apnea. Apnea, by definition, means no air movement or no breathing. So sleep apnea is no air movement that occurs during sleep. Usually it's an obstruction in the upper throat that prevents air from entering the lungs. During an apnea that's of the obstructive nature, a person's blood pressure will initially sink and then skyrocket after the apnea is relieved. Heart rate sinks and then zooms up after you relieve the apnea. The central type is where the brain will forget to send the signal to the lungs to breathe, and oxygen levels can decrease during that particular event as well. If you have sleep apnea, you're at risk for diabetes, you're at risk for heart disease, heart abnormalities, and we know that people with sleep apnea will die a lot more frequently than people who don't have sleep apnea. So as a physician who treats sleep apnea, I think it's of utmost importance to maintain good, healthy sleep habits, and then to treat sleep apnea because of all the complications that may go with it. Now, how do you know if you have sleep apnea? As a patient, one of the biggest things you'll notice is that you feel like your sleep doesn't ever satisfy you. You wake up in the mornings and you sleep 10, maybe 12 hours, and you never feel like you got fully rested. And then you tend to fall asleep when you really shouldn't. The big things are if you're trying to watch a movie, if you sit down to read the newspaper, if you read a book, then you'll fall asleep during those things, even though that activity may hold your interest. The biggest thing to recognize is drowsiness. And then if you combine drowsiness with snoring, then usually people will have sleep apnea with those two complaints. If you add a third indicator in, if you have high blood pressure, snoring, and drowsiness, you about 95 to 99% of the time have sleep apnea. So just those three simple things will be predictive of sleep apnea in a large number of people. The primary one is known as a polysomnogram, and it's multiple channels, which include tracings of brain waves, eye movements, muscle movements in the chin, snoring, muscle movements in the chest, oxygen saturation or levels. Additionally, some of the more unusual tests can be done during the daytime. There's something called a multiple sleep latency test, which is useful in diagnosing something like idiopathic CNS hypersomnolence, drowsiness for unexplained reasons, or diagnosing a condition known as narcolepsy. Those are often done with naps and are daytime studies. After a polysomnogram is completed, additional testing may involve a CPAP, which is a small mask worn over the nose or mouth to push pressure into the airways and the upper throat to hold it open during sleep. You can use another form of pressure known as BiPAP, which is delivered in a slightly different way through a same device. There's another device called assisted servoventilation that can be used for central sleep apnea. So the devices and masks and multiple interfaces between the patient and the pressure-providing device are available through this particular sleep center. People who successfully treat sleep apnea, doctors, and patients who have successful treatment for sleep apnea that they can tolerate well will find huge changes in their life. They'll get more energy, they'll be able to stay awake during events that they couldn't before. Some people with extremely severe sleep apnea will be literally pulled from the brink of death back to functioning lifestyles and back to normal daily function. So it's tremendously satisfying from a physician standpoint and from a patient standpoint when it works well, because it is literally a life-altering treatment.
For more information about this physician or to schedule an appointment, please call our referral line or visit notbiggerjustbetterhealth.com.